Well, welcome everyone to day 58 of what we strongly hope will be a 60-day session. The events on the floor obviously delayed us, but after 20 years with the Lieutenant Governor, that's not to be unexpected. This week, obviously, the full attention is on the budget and passing that budget. There's some things out there that I think are complicating it. One very enormous factor is pretending that we're not going to fund K-3 class size in the next biennium. That, to achieve a four-year balanced budget, really just doesn't work. Nobody at this table expects that we're not going to fund K-3 class size, so why should we play along with that? We're looking at work with the Department of Corrections investigation. That's what one senator is joining us. I think one of the other things with the agencies came out today with employment security, that we're paying people in jail unemployment insurance. That's ridiculous. Who's minding the store for the people that pay into that fund, employees and employers? And, you know, we need another bill or another law to take care of that. These people are supposed to be searching for employment. How do you search for employment when you're in jail? I mean, certainly they have dropped the ball there in yet another agency. So with that, I've got Senator Patton, our corrections and judiciary chair, Senator Parlett, our caucus chair, and I'll turn it over to JT.
Well, thank you for being here today. In the House, we have similar interests, I think. One of the things that's a little bit different is we've yet to take any action on charter schools, which is why Representative Magandas is here. We hope to have that taken care of in the next couple of days. We also are optimistic that we get a budget out. Inside that budget, we feel strongly about wildfires and a number of reform and accountability issues, and we appreciate the leadership from the Senate that has made this a session that really is about transparency and accountability. We have Representative Magandas and Representative Short with us.
Charter schools, what is happening with that? And at this point, is there been information that the Senate can support and that members of the Republicans in the House can support?
Go ahead, Chad.
So, we've got, I think, a tentative agreement on both sides. Talking to Senator Lizzo this morning and members of the House Democratic Caucus. There's some discussion right now about the vehicle, whether we'll strike it onto 6194 or House Bill 3000 or even potentially 3002, which is a narrower title. And we're looking at any potential amendments that might come up on the floor, and we haven't had a chance to review those yet. But I think we're very close to moving a bill.
Do you expect that to happen today?
I expect we'll need some time to digest the amendments after they're on the bar, so my guess would be today would be an aggressive goal, probably tomorrow.
Can you say what the deal does?
Let's see. So I think it addresses, at a high level, it addresses some of the concerns the HDC was seeing about having more oversight from superintendent of public instruction and an opportunity for districts to have right of first refusal. It eliminates conversion schools, which is a concession on our side. And I think that really kind of captures a lot of the changes that were discussed. There's some other minor elements that are just corrections to errors that were in the original drafting, but the rest is just mainly technical.
Does this solve the issues that the Supreme Court raised in your view?
Oh, I think the original bill addressed the issues that was in the Supreme Court ruling. Those were focused on the constitutionality of the funding sources. What I believe this iteration does is it kind of looks ahead and tries to anticipate if there would be any further challenges to the constitutionality and try to address those before they're actually brought up in the courts.
Is there going to be a Voting Rights Act compromise reached?
Conversations went on right through cutoff day, and we haven't yet gotten there.
Are you going to get there in the next 2 days?
I think right now all of the bandwidth is focused on getting the three budgets out of here, because that is the one thing we do really need to do that we all agree on.
Will you guys pass it by Thursday?
You know, I hope we do. I still believe that I'm the glass half full caucus, and we'll remain optimistic.
You realize we're not going to quote that ever again. Extremely helpful as to where things are at.
Well, there's been progress. There has been progress, and I think in my opening remarks, I covered the fact that using the K-3 class size in the next biennium to make a four-year balanced budget is simply not a realistic position for a four-year balanced budget.
Are you willing to give it all on the four-year balanced budget requirement? I know it's, in statute or it's a requirement.
I don't think we should, because the four-year balanced budget is a bipartisan tool voted on and for by Representative Dunshee and many others that is an excellent tool to keep our state from the roller coaster ride of budgets we've experienced. For those of you that have been here a while, go back to 2008 when people said, we have no deficit. We have no deficit. And sure enough, when we arrived in 2009, the Senate Ways and Means Committee staff report that we had a big deficit was alive and real. So we want to take the state out of the budget roller coaster. And you can look back, people like Representative Dunshee voted for it.
You know, from the House perspective, that was passed when we were in a deep minority. But we are the caucus over there that defends it in the most strongly. And we believe that is the one tool. In fact, it may be the best tool of any state in the country for managing a runaway bow wave. And that's what we care about.
Well, and if I could add to that, you think about the fiscal notes that are done on proposed legislation, a lot of times what we would see is the costs would be purposely very low in the first biennium, and then those costs would be pushed out into, out years where it really looked like the cost of the bill was very little when in actuality it was actually very large. And so I think the four-year budget outlook has actually helped that process as well. So we get a better idea of the costs and know how to fold that into the budget.
I would say that I was in the room in 2012 when our governor at that time, Christine Gregoire, helped negotiate that because Senator Hewitt was in the hospital at the time, so I stepped in as leader. And that was well worked, where you would estimate about a 4% return in year 3 and 4. It really works for all of us because both Republicans and Democrats, when they've been in the majority in the past, have had a tendency to get out when they want to get out and kick the can down the road. And we're kind of tired of hearing that. It's nice to know that we don't hear that often every other budget year. So I think it's really good for all of us to have that in statute and all of us follow it.
What about tapping the rainy day fund as part of a plan?
In the Senate, we believe that it's a last resort. And that's why our budget we released did not tap it. Other places, they may think it's a first resort. We think it's a last.
You're 2 days away from the end of the session. Isn't this last resort time?
It could be. But remember, if we use it for anything but a one-time expense, we create an unsustainable bow wave in our four-year balanced budget. And if we start paying ongoing operating costs from that fund, then when we come back here, trying to meet public safety and education becomes all but impossible.
I don't know if there's anyone here who's working on transportation, but you probably have been involved in some discussion. There looks like there was an agreement reached on transportation and then some sort of budget introduced this morning. It did include some money for state patrol raises, but not as much as the House. Senator Schessler or anyone else who might have been involved, can you speak a little bit to that compromise and how that was reached and whether it meets the goals?
Well, I'm not familiar with the House language for sure, but like every other budget, it is a compromise. Is it everything that the majority coalition wanted? Probably not. Is it everything the House wanted? Probably not.
What about the governor's, I guess it's more than a threat because he said he would do it, promise to start vetoing bills Thursday, I think, if there is an appointment.
I think there are bipartisan problems with doing that. I think there's 37 bills that passed unanimously, and I think there's a variety of subjects that that would be a very poor decision.
Is it a useful tool, though, to nudge the... I mean, I think he framed it in the idea that the legislator, the budget negotiators need a deadline. Maybe the 60 days isn't enough, so here's something to kind of add incentive to negotiate.
We're still committed to doing the right thing, and the right thing is a four-year balanced budget that takes care of the priority needs of the state.
You know, every bill is important to somebody, so we don't discount the importance of those, and I hope that the governor doesn't either, because there are people that are you know, critically relying on the outcome of some of those bills. On the other hand, we also, especially after years in the minority, understand that a lot of times you don't get what you want, but you do have to stand up for your principles and your priorities. And for us in general, a responsible budget has always been the top priority.
Senator Patton?
Well, there's some important other bills that I think would be very difficult to veto dealt with human traffic awareness day and number of other things that are important. The governor said yesterday in his press conference he'd sign 5105, which is the felony DUI bill that Speaker Chop now said he's seriously looking at. So we're hopeful that may finally get through the House. So there's a number of, bills on both sides that would be difficult for him to veto. I don't know how serious he was in actually vetoing it, or if it was more of a rhetorical statement.
The legislature either goes to the limit or goes into overtime on every single budget negotiation.
Absolutely not. 2 years ago, we adjourned on time.
That's like one out of...
Well, let's get it right. Get it right, John, 2 years ago, not every time.
The legislature has a very poor record of getting a budget done on time. Why shouldn't the governor force you guys to stay within your time limit? Why can't you guys, and I'll hold the D's at the same standard, why can't the two sides get a budget done on time?
You know, I think every side, without trying to distinguish between Republicans and Democrats right now, is fully committed to doing the best possible job according to their conscience. You know, all of us have to look in the mirror, and the best possible job for the people that rely on them. And that, you know, to most people means that you don't give up easily. These people in general are as committed to doing their job as you are. And that means that they're going to try until the last minute to do it. And it's unfortunate that the deadline doesn't mean as much as it should, but that doesn't mean that everyone here doesn't care about doing the best possible job for the people that rely on them.
Well, I'd like to add something, too. You know, when you go back to 2008 when the recession kicked in, that was when I was first in the legislature. There were some, at that time we were dealing with significant bow waves of spending and then with the reduction in revenue. And I think when you think of all of the things that we've had to grapple with, I'm not making an excuse, but we had to grapple with significant issues. It took time to put those together. And then I would also, you know, look at all of the funding we put into education. There have been, and the reductions in higher ed tuition and all of those things. We have dealt with significant monumental issues since then. And so I think there has been a lot of work on both sides, regardless of the time that it took to get there, significant issues to the state of Washington.
It seems like what part of the Democrats were weighing for themselves is if there's a cut into what's the term, maintenance level spending, that, and you don't tap the rainy day fund, that then they're trying to figure out if it's worth it to them to just leave things as they are and not do a supplemental budget.
I think the only ones that have talked about no budget seem to be the House Democrats. The governor says he wants a budget. My caucus wants a budget. Sure, JT's does.
We
so
sure as heck do.
We haven't taken that position. Really, Senator Hargrove had a major role in writing our budget. He didn't just get a courtesy visit, he was in the room all the time. Do you really think we could have written a budget with Jim Hargrove that cut human services? No way. I mean, he's passionate about it, and he was respected in that process. Did we increase things? Probably not. Did we start enough new programs for some? Definitely not. But the cuts to human services weren't there because Jim Hargrove was at the table, and we believe in working together in common goals in the Senate.
We have to remember, too, this is a supplemental budget, and the revenue forecast was not real positive. We started the session with unexpended costs, specifically from the health care authority, a few other caseload differences. So we started this year with less money than we thought. We certainly less left in July of 2015 in good shape. So it's our goal, at least in the Senate, to have a balanced budget and make it easier to start out right in 2017.
Sir, Madden, I may have come in late. Did you guys already agree to use the rainy day fund in the Senate to use it for the fire?
No.
And you guys did agree to the House?
No, there's a lot of proposals going around, but there's no final decision.
So where will you get the money for the fires to deal with the wildfire damage?
You know, we had a proposal, we're looking at options, but as I said earlier, John, the budget stabilization account is not the first resort, it's the last.
Senator Patton, did you have a chance to review the additions to the governor's investigators report that came out?
I just briefly, it seemed to focus on the two witnesses that had, you know, contested the initial report, Mr. Dunnington and Sue Schuler, but really didn't get into, as far as I could tell, any more on Bernie Warner. And I think the Senate's investigation certainly has indicated from current, you know, Secretary Pachocki and others that we have a disengaged head of DOC during the time Bernie Warner was there. He was traveling all the time to these conferences. He wasn't there very much. When he was there, he was pushing his special projects and to the exclusion of the normal maintenance for the IT department. So there are a number of things. And then, in addition to that, we brought out a story that you wrote over a year ago about a couple of people that were whistleblowers and faced retribution and whose trial is still ongoing. So while the governor said yesterday that, you know, he would have fired Bernie or Bernie would have resigned, I think it really took the Senate's investigation to bring that whole issue to the forefront, because the initial report somewhat absolved Bernie Warner from responsibility. And it's easier to go after the little guys, which they've done. And I'm not saying they didn't have some responsibility and culpability, but I really think it should have focused a little more on Bernie Warner. And then you ask, you know, who's watching Bernie Warner? Who's watching that department? What was the governor's office doing there? He was, renominated by the governor to continue. So there's certainly some things we haven't, we don't anticipate any more hearings this session, obviously, but we haven't ended the investigation. We're still getting comments and leads and communications from DOC workers. So
yeah, you previously had anticipated more hearings. So why pushing them off?
Well, there could certainly be another hearing. We will have some sort of report that we will, when we're ready on it, and at that we'll probably have a meeting of the committee. Hopefully the session will be over, but it would be down the road a little bit. We're still gathering some information. It's still a possibility there could be additional hearings. I'm just saying I don't expect any now in the next couple days.
Do you have money, do you still have any of your appropriation left to continue the probe?
Well,
and if not, are you gonna try to get extra money in the budget compromise?
Well, all the billings are not in from the Senate. My understanding is they're not all in on the governor's budget either. So that'll be seen. The F&O did authorize $125,000 And I expect that money, you know, will be spent, and that's all that's authorized.
I would assume we're okay, because if you reach the limit, right before you reach the limit, we have to be notified. And as SFNO chair, I've not been notified, so I'm sure we're within what we have authorized.
Okay, are you satisfied that what you saw in about the little guys, as you call it, Dave Dunnington, for example, the investigators didn't seem to be buying his statements that, you know, for his rationale for downgrading some of these priorities. Did that make sense to you, or do you think there's still discrepancies there?
Well, I think Mr. Dunnington still has. We, you know, that just came out. It's a long deal. I just saw it a little while ago, so I haven't been able to go over it as thoroughly as I would like. But, you know, I mean, certainly those investigators may be right on him and the responsibility and culpability of some of these smaller folks. But you got to remember too, some of them that got reprimands, Wendy, Stiegel, she was the one that kept trying to get it fixed, you know, a number of times. And what I don't know is, you know, the overall atmosphere, the culture there seemed to make it difficult sometimes for people to talk to upper management.
Again, 2.5 days left in the session. You're waiting for the bills to come in on the probe. Is there a chance you're going to have to ask for extra money for the probe?
Not that I know of, John. I mean, I'm glad we've actually done this investigation. If it were your family member that had been killed by somebody who shouldn't have been released, I mean, just the cost of those potential lawsuits make $120,000 a small amount of money. Right. I mean, this is serious business, and I don't think right now we're focusing on the cost of the investigation. And by the way, just like with the governor's investigators, the attorneys cut their hourly wage in half. So I think that was gracious of them to do so due to the seriousness of this matter. I mean, the fact that this has been unknown for so long, and we just learned about it not too long ago, is quite frankly shameful.
You know, speaking for the House, where we're not doing these kinds of investigations, I'm glad that they're putting this much effort into it. And I think because the Senate started off the session feeling committed, not just to fund requests, but to understand what's happening in executive agencies, we have a new, the beginning at least, of a culture of responsibility. And when you look at the governor's press conferences recently, it's mostly been about how do we figure out how to make government and agencies work better. I think that's a darn good thing. And are we counting the cost at this small level? Well, we care about the costs all the time, but I'm doggone glad that they're doing it.
So would you expect some sort of final report to come out of your committee or something?
Well, if we don't have something unexpected happen, I would think in sometime in April or early May.
It'd be an actual written.
We hope to have a written report, yes.
What kind of action would you take against Bernie Warner? You talked about how not enough responsibility has been placed on him, but within not in the state, what would you do?
Well, I think I think there needs to be some additional like performance audits. So I think Senator Melosia has had a number of ideas on reforming agencies of state government and having objective standards as whether they're doing the job. And certainly, you know, we know some agencies seem to work real well. Ironically, the Department of Revenue seems to work very well in getting money, but some of the other agencies don't seem to work so well. And certainly the Department of Corrections is in there. Governor has appointed an interim director. It's a guy that's been around a long time. He's not been active with the department since 2010. He has been active as an activist working on the death penalty issue, but he's not been involved since that time. So we'll see how he does. I would have preferred that he maybe brought somebody new in outside that wasn't part of this system and this culture that's been there. And they did ask, I'll give them credit there, they did ask myself and Senator Oban, we both thought it might be preferable to have somebody from the outside, but in any event, we'll see how Mr. Morgan's able to do.
Senator Chancellor, the Voting Rights Act continues to sit, awaiting action in the Senate. Is it going to be voted on, and
what's holding up the Senate from voting on
this? We weren't able to reach a compromise, Jerry.
You have not?
We haven't been able to. I mean, it was, you didn't see us block it in rules. I mean, we pulled Senator Roach's bill. The Democrats pulled their bill at the first cutoff. House bill came over. Lieutenant Governor pulled it. We had no complaints. I met right up to the last day with the sponsor and other proponents, hoping we'd have a breakthrough.
And you don't think it was time? Do you think it's dead?
Well, I think you look at the focus is on the budgets. The focus is on your other questions today. It's unfortunate, but we worked right up to the end.
Is the issue the state courts involved?
That's one of the biggest issues that, the counties are still opposed. The cities have concerns. That was one stumbling block.
And is there something else?
You know, the others, that's probably the largest single detail. The others are parts that you could probably move around with a little easier.
Given the issues that remain on the budget, how likely do you think it is that you will complete your work by Thursday and not at the bonus special session?
See how today's offer sheet goes. I haven't, we met with Senator Braun and the House and Senate leadership, met with my leadership team, and we hope that this offer is the one that breaks the final hurdles.
The capital budget caught up in that, or is that?
Capital budget isn't resolved, but it's a simpler vehicle because there's $89 million to negotiate over. It's relatively simple.
Do you think you'll have a capital budget?
I think we should. It's our goal to have one.
One more question. That's great. Thank you.
There's another Jerry. Bill in the Senate. I'm getting a lot of emails. The martial arts studio, the sales tax. The House passed it. Is the Senate plan to pass the repeal that?
You know, it's interesting now. It has minor fiscal implications. It's also very interesting that the same people that scream about all the tax exemptions voted for this one. Thank you.